question is to whoever wants to take it. Obviously, sexual trafficking and the amount of, you know, people who are in, the numbers of people in trafficking are astounding. My question is, for once, I guess, a victim is recovered, what's the, you know, what's the trajectory of their life? Where is the aid? Like, what's the next step? Because, I mean, how do you rehabilitate someone who's gone through that trauma when there's an astounding number of people in it?
I think what I've seen in terms of my travels around the world, there are phenomenal shelters around the world where these victims are assisted to, and you will find, when you ask them, you say, what's the first thing that you do? Often with children, they'll say, we give them a safe place. And one of the first things that they look for is whether or not the child smiles. Some of these children have become so traumatized and so blank, they've even lost they're just traumatized. And so they'll feed them, they'll nourish them, they'll have them understand that they're in a safe place. Different shelters obviously have different levels of resources. It ranges from Hagar in Cambodia, where they make a commitment to be there for that person for life. And they really give them therapeutic help and resources for life, because they feel that the issues that somebody is left with will continue to cycle back through their life. And other shelters work with people for 3 months and then pass them on. But there's all sorts of challenges to shelters in terms of one of the interventions, especially with children, is that they're not immediately reconnected with their parents. They have to go through a process of psychologically understanding. They work with the parent and they work with the child to get them to a point where they can have a trusting relationship when they come back, because often it's the parent that was duped, or the parent was involved in selling the child in the first place. So there's a lot of psychological rehabilitative care. People are taught within that environment great skill sets that will give them a sustainable job. You see a great deal of that. And what you see more than anything is this phenomenal resilience of the human spirit. And you go and you meet with these girls, these boys who've had extraordinary atrocities put upon them, and they're just phenomenally inspirational.
I think what they need the most is what the other thing that we can ask the business community to not just look at their supply chains, not just look at the activism that they can do, but at the end of the day, jobs. Hiring trafficking victims is one of the best things that people in the business community can do. These are people who work hard, they suffered something horrible, but they're motivated. We have a number of survivors in the United States who are now business owners themselves. I was on a panel last week with a young woman who is getting her law degree at Southern Methodist University. And what happened to her is not her. She is a survivor, but that is one aspect of her. It fuels what she does. But jobs are a great way to have rehabilitation. There's some heroes out there like Starwood and Marriott who are getting escaped slaves into training programs, because they recognize that that's a good thing that they can do, and it also helps their bottom line.
I think your question highlights that there are several levels that need to be addressed almost at the same time. One is prevention, one is advocacy, which is what we've tried to do with the campaign, but of course a lot of it ongoing is also relief on the ground. And the way we've tried to address it, we have the global campaign, which has been very focused on advocacy and driving long-term legislative change, our global framework, legal framework change. In parallel to that, through the Body Shop Foundation, we support grassroots organizations who do a lot of this relief on the ground. So for instance, last month, I was in Nepal, where we have a supplier we've been working with for more than 15 years. And they're one of our community fair trade suppliers, and they've not only created a lot of job and economic wealth in this area of Kathmandu, which is not particularly privileged, but they're dedicating, and we're supporting them through the foundation to do that, every year a specific amount of their revenues to run programs on education and on relief on sex trafficking, which is a big issue in Nepal, particularly between Nepal and India. And so what I think what was particularly striking to me, and I think I concur to what you just said, is to see the incredible strength of these girls, those girls in that instance that I met, where it's hard to imagine what they've gone through, and they only share a little bit of what it's been, but the strength that they have in taking action to rebuild not only their lives, but most often to become peer-to-peer educators back in their villages and to kickstart some income-generating activities which prevent them and their peers to get trapped is absolutely mind-blowing.
And everyone can be involved. You know, one of the things that we're saying with the slavery footprint application is that there are things that you can do that can offset the fact that your lifestyle is being supported by all of these slaves. Obviously, somebody who's going and volunteering in a shelter, somebody who has their philanthropic work, whether it's writing a check or being out there over Christmas vacation, and other things, doing the volunteer work. And we've seen people you know, make that kind of their life's work. And everyone can do that, no matter what your role is.
Thank you. Alice Hornbold with Fast Company. The work you're doing is magnificent, and it's just amazing. So congratulations to all of you. I have two questions. The second one, do after, please, which is, can you name some organizations that we should support to support your work? But first, I wanted to ask you, one of you mentioned calling INS when you see this is happening. So my worry is, to what extent are some of these folks returned to countries where life was pretty bad? Not that this is a good thing, but I mean, not that their situation here is a good thing. So to what extent does that happen? So what happens to all of these people?
Well, because of Bill Clinton, that is not a problem. One of the last laws that President Clinton signed into law in the fall of 2000 was the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, which allows a person to get what's called a T visa, to stay in the United States and even bring their families over from their home country. Despite the fact that they may have been here illegally, despite the fact that they may have chosen to come in illegally, it's not that they were kidnapped necessarily. They may have come here and then become enslaved. It's basically predicated on the argument that President Clinton made at the time, which is, if this most horrible thing that goes against everything we are as a nation, that violates this promise that was made by President Lincoln 149 years ago today, if that happens to someone in America now, the least we can do for them is to take care of their immigration status. And the folks over at the Immigration Service are very serious about this. The numbers are not as high as we would like. We'd like to see more people getting this status. But the folks who apply get it at a pretty good rate. And when you see that family member, when you see the child get reunited with their parents at the airport, a woman who hasn't seen her husband and children or her parents for all those years because she was enslaved in a suburban house in the U.S., being there for that moment makes this all worth it.
And in terms of other organizations to support, we have here, I wonder if it'd be helpful if people, if you're from an NGO or you're working on social union, stand up so that guys can see, and then maybe afterwards people can follow up with an interview. Come on, Brad, stand up. This is from Polaris. Sarah's here from Free the Slaves. David Arklis is here from Manpower. Anybody who's working on the issue who
Rachel
would like
Lloyd
to talk to press. So track these guys down and get stories from them individually.
Ours, MTV, a partner with Free the Slaves, Polaris Project, and GEMS, and there's representatives from all of those groups. The heads of them are here if you want to speak to them afterwards.
And I'm not sure why he didn't stand up, but the president of SlaveryFootprint.org, Justin Mill.
Hi, my name is Janelle Gallucci. I'm with Media Planet Publishing, and I'm currently publishing a section of USA Today on investing in women and girls globally. The work you guys are doing is amazing, and we are looking to cover a section on human trafficking. So my question for you guys is, to your knowledge, are women and girls disproportionately affected? And if so, what are those some of those statistics?
Well, one of the statistics that really stands out for me is that, and I can correct myself later if I'm making this up, is that I think that our stats indicate that a majority of women in labor a majority of the victims of labor trafficking are women. You know, which is a little counterintuitive. Everybody had typically said, "Oh, well, you know, sex trafficking, that's women and girls, and labor trafficking, that's men." But when you think about the most vulnerable jobs, agriculture, most of the farmers, most of the people who farm in the world are women. If you look at domestic service, which is almost exclusively women and almost exclusively abusive around the world, women. So that notion that it's not just women, sex trafficking, men, labor trafficking, but the majority of the labor trafficking victims are women, I think has to make us refocus some of the assumptions we've had on how we fight this crime. But it's, again, the resilience is amazing. We've got a young woman who we were able to help airlift to Malta, who was basically tortured by the Gaddafi family, who was found when CNN went in to film one of their palaces a few weeks ago. And, you know, they poured boiling water on her to punish her. And just the most horrible things you've ever seen. And one of the things that came out was she kept asking to try to make sure that the guard who had tried to help her had not been punished for it. So even this woman who all of our hearts went out to.
And all of whom are American girls, all of whom entered the sex industry, 12, 13, 14, 15, and who are not ever really treated as victims. And so a lot of the healing that happens and a lot of the kind of rehabilitation process is really about how we as a society treat victims and how we either stigmatize them and make them feel like on the outside, or how we bring them in and include them and make sure that their expertise and their experience is at the table. Thanks.
I hope we'll be successful in the US with the petition too, because our petition in the US is specifically focused on that, so that the safe harbor laws are not only in full state, but in as many states as possible, which is a contributor to helping on this issue. So I hope it will be as successful as possible.